London is the world's greatest city and the biggest. It covers an area of 700 square miles and has a population of 9 million. Although London is continually swallowing its own past, it is pleasant to see so much old world charm still remaining. This 700-year-old church at Perivale and its rectory are fulfilling their original object. These tall gates at St. Paul's and in the village of Dulwich remind us that even before the days of road funds and Belisha beacons, we couldn't travel when and where we wanted. The old pound at Wimbledon tells us that straying cattle were impounded here. The windmill must have been surrounded by cornfields. This ancient water wheel at Mitcham is turning wheels of industry, actually of the old lavender and scent factory. The river Wandle and its waterfall. In the meadows round here, you may catch your tiddlers, as in the days when we were young. This is no village station, but Honor Oak on the main line of the Southern Railway. Ely Place off Holborn, where the night watchman has been calling the hour for generations, where the biblical rite of sanctuary is preserved to this day. Nobody can be arrested here, except by its own policeman. If you know your Pickwick, you'll recognize the George Inn at Southwark, now preserved for the nation. The Green Man at Roehampton used to be considered so far from London that highwaymen greeted passers-by something like this, your money or your life. While London has been spreading and stretching, it has remained unique among the great cities of the world in this way. It has insisted on holding on to its open spaces and the almost greedy way in which it acquires more whenever possible. Wild animals have roamed on Richmond Park for hundreds of years. Now tame deer dwell in peace. Drat that fly, this one seems to say. Wimbledon Common is London's largest open space. You can see where Caesar dug his well and camped 2,000 years ago. Nowadays, Londoners do what they please. They come or stay away, as you see. At Hampstead Heath, perhaps London's most popular open space, there has been more digging. And what for, do you think? Lovely white silver sand for bird cages and pubs. Now then, you brush holes, recognize this? Golf was introduced at Blackheath into this country.
Yes, very well.
Say, Papa, is that your boat or mine? And does Grandpa look pleased?
I'm sure he does.
So this is London, always the same, always changing. Old-time exclusive squares like fashionable Berkeley Square cannot prevent progress. Can this be true? A car park in St. James's Square. The Dickens, what Charles Dickens himself might say at finding offices in his beloved Golden Square. You would be interested to know that the largest building in this square is occupied by the largest cinema company in the country. Park Lane, changing from the most expensive houses to the most costly flats. Sentiment and veneration for old buildings don't stop progress, even if they delay it. All over London, new buildings replace old ones. Down they come, up they go. All change, change for the better. Steel framework of the new London. It hardly seems believable. What we call London is more than 1,000 years old, yet half of it is always less than 50 years of age. Old, worn-out buildings disappearing. new ones rising in all their glory. After all has been said about how old London is, how open spaces are preserved, how changes are taking place, the greatest interest in any town or city is in its people, especially when there are 9 millions of them, mostly working for the living in office, shop, warehouse and factory. You see them on the Great London Bridge and King's Wing. Aldwych going to their offices, to Bush House, the first of that new kind of office where everything in it is up to date. They are in the offices of Messrs. Lever Brothers, in the offices of the Imperial Chemical Industries, two of the largest trading companies in the British Empire, which you are seeing as they appear from the embankment. The offices of Shell Mex, Hotel Cecil that was. You see where they work in and about Fleet Street. There used to be a saying that people in glass houses should never throw stones, but we want to know, does the newspaper claiming the largest daily circulation in the world never throw stones? Rolls of paper are poured into presses all the livelong day. Forcing millions of people to buy them, molding their opinions. We must not forget that London is the greatest industrial city in the whole wide world and has the largest port and docks. Tens of thousands work on these wharves on the River Lee. On these wharves at Greenwich. In these dreary factories, as black as any in the black country. Even in the heart of the city there are many dreary spots with very famous names. Look at Paternoster Row, where the Bible was first printed in this country. That's how it got its name. Coal Lane, because coal used to be brought here from the River Fleet. Now paper, always something to be burned. There are unfortunately lots of ugly places where people work, so it will be more pleasant to show something of the new, wonderful industrial London. Real palaces of industry, where work is done under pleasant conditions, providing comfort, cleanliness and opportunities for acquiring that self-respect and pride which cannot be measured in pounds, shillings and pence. Although money does help, what say you? These companies are all very familiar through the large amount of money spent on advertising. We regret to inform you that neither directly nor indirectly have we had any. Worse luck, especially as everybody who sees this picture says most emphatically we are entitled to some. Where in the world is there a street like this? A real forecast of the shape of things to come. And believe it or not, there is an agricultural industry in London too. Dairymaids, farm labourers, tops, aren't there? Cows grazing in front of buses, trams and houses, all complete in one of the best equipped model farms in the country. Actually, no further away than Finchley. Be it ever so humble, the Londoner's home is his castle. Whether it is one of these 300-year-old houses at Morden, or one of these 200-year-old at Ham. In the beginning, all houses are detached, like these at Camden Hill. and Kensington, bravely resisting change. Or in these ultra-modern houses. Next door neighbors of the late Ramsay MacDonald. Bath House, last of the great mansions in Piccadilly, still detached, being crowded out, will soon be demolished and when rebuilt will probably look something like Devonshire House, its very old neighbor. Now, much as we admire the skill with which these wooden war shacks have been beautified, they're not worth preserving to live in, are they? You'll be glad to know that the sordid, miserable-looking places like these at Greenwich are disappearing soon. Let us hope there is a silver lining for the people living in these hovels in Silvertown. We could show you a lot more of this sort of thing. Old, broken-down villages like this at Earl's Court. Let's call on the auctioneer and get his ultimatum. Going, going, gone. As space becomes scarcer, houses get nearer. See this long street in Bloomsbury, where artists dwell. Not very artistic. Even the artists must be snappy nowadays. London is not so leisurely now. Here is the famous church row of Queen Anne cottages, 200 years old. Cheyne Walk, Chelsea, the very name of this and of the many other walks, tell of the time when walking was a daily habit, before hiking was a weekend sport. Lacking nowadays are these pretty girls and crinolines taking the waters at this one-time fashionable spa at Well Walk, Hampstead. Horses are disappearing, but the old stables are not wasted. Shops for horses have been converted into cocktail bars. The stables have become little fairyland dwellings inside. Carlton House Terrace, so near Government Department, famous for the many ambassadors who have lived there. Tree-lined streets of houses are all over London too, at Palace Gate. Queen's Gate. Inverness Terrace, Hyde Park. It is not too well known that you can very rarely find a spot in London where there is no green. Isn't it strange now that the smallest house in London should be right opposite Hyde Park, neighbour of some of the biggest? Cheers to men! These houses in Belgravia are occupied by pillars of society. Anyway, that's what they look like. Londoners have been forced to live further and further away. And now we get villadom in places like Wimbledon and Blackheath. Tens of thousands of more modest houses have been built on these great new roads constructed since the war, on the Barnard Bypass, on the West Way. North Circular Road, actually part of the famous Hampstead Garden Suburb. But we are glad to say that a wonderful garden city has been built at St. Helier's, far, far away on the main London to Brighton Road. More of these, please, gentlemen of the LCC. Town must have limits, so we must build upwards. When these Drury Lane flats came into existence, they were considered to be so posh they were nicknamed the poor man's Ritz. New flats replacing, like these, at Drury Lane, are transforming whole districts as in Cumberland Market, Camden Town. Borough. Clapham. I'm sure you like these playgrounds. The Oval, near the famous cricket ground, and the nearly equally famous gasworks. Then there are flats all over London, built to cope with the maid problem. The higher the flat, the fewer the maids. You see, there's the trouble of getting money and the trouble when you've got it. All those of us who haven't got it, however, are quite prepared to risk this kind of trouble. Luxury flats for those with plenty of money to pay rent soaring to the sky. But at Dolphin Square, Victoria, you see the largest block of flats in all Europe. Middle-class flats, 1,214 of them. We will repeat it, 1,214. London must also accommodate about 1 million guests night and day. So you see here a little bit of hotel there. In all the suburbs, there are first-class family hotels. Bridge, golf, tennis, and other attractions, and no next-door neighbor. There are markets in every part of London, whose origins go very far back, gradually disappearing in some directions and becoming more important in others. The best-known market in London is Covent Garden. Land of opera, oranges and onions. Fast workers here, for London's appetite is never satisfied. It constantly needs refilling. We would like to tell you that most of this picture has been photographed with a cinematograph snapshot camera. Everybody in it has been taken unaware. Natural, no posing. Smithfield collects and distributes more meat than any market in the world. Southwark Market. Just underneath the cathedral. Peculiar place for a market. Southall on market day. Jealously preserved by the people of the village. Petticoat Lane, once the most notorious market in the country, now one of the most famous. People of every race, colour and creed, but Londoners all, come here for bargains. Berwick Market, between theatre land of Shaftesbury Avenue and film land of Wardour Street. Farringdon Market. Bookworms looking for first editions in the tuppenny box. While out, the inner man needs catering form. On the doorstep, spread with tips from the racing edition. There's a cup of tea or coffee, mostly run by old soldiers. If you want something elegant, this represents an old-fashioned tea room, of which there are thousands. And if you want to swank, there are magnificent places with marble halls, marble walls, and music. Outside bitter tastes better. And there are picnics in all the parks. But to most people, to women particularly, shopping, things to wear, to look nice in, are even more important than food. In days gone by, shopping used to be done in streets like this. A sort of quality street. These little dog and antique shops are in Beecham Place, if you want to know. London consists of a lot of boroughs looking very much alike, each with its own shopping centre, as at Lewisham or Kensington. Can you see that great store at Knightsbridge? Regent Street is the magic magnet to Eve and her daughters. Oh, hats. 'Tis in Oxford Street ladies linger longer. Alas for the window in between. And what about men? For every smart man loves a tailor. We beg the world, says Savile Row. The world pays sooner or later. Generally later. Notice the difference between shop for men and shop for women. No window dressing, window gazing or crowds here. St. James's, the only district in the world catering entirely for men and famous for its cigars, wine, and clubs. Moving 9 million people about is London's biggest daily problem. You see them going to and from Waterloo and Charing Cross and all the other stations which we can't show you. Isn't it rather surprising to find that 1,000 old-fashioned steam trains leave London every day? Trains in motion are very fascinating. No wonder children love them. The Tube has played a big part in the growth of London. This Hendon Tube station, one of nearly 200 stations, only a few years ago was a field, far from the madding crowd. Now part of a service containing the longest tunnel in the world, 45 miles. Morden. Already hundreds of thousands of people acquiring houses in these districts, thinking that they would at least get seats in the morning, now complain that neither by day nor night can they sit or stand. This Lotts Road power station supplies power for the whole of the Tube and Underground system. While we are talking about power stations, you can see two of these at Chelsea and Battersea, which provide electricity. Your buses are wonderful, say visitors. So they are. So are their drivers and conductors. You will see these buses all over the world, recommended by visitors, sometimes new, but frequently after they've done their bit here. Trams have played their part too, but must be replaced soon, leaving memories behind. One more stage removed from the days of the old stagecoach. According to records, Hyde Park Corner is the busiest traffic spot in London. A London taxi. Prop, what's this? Now, some father will say 20 years from now, that's a horse. When motor cars appeared in the streets, the breed disappeared. But when you're older, I'll take you to the races, and you'll see why they are still bred. But traffic must have roads. Here we are on Highgate Hill, one of the great north roads, thinking of Dick Whittington as he climbed and dreamed and rested on this very spot, when he heard Bull Bells calling him to turn back. Now we're down south on the Campbellwell New Road, so called because it is only 200 years young and going strong. Commercial Road, way down east, near Dockland. Regent Street, the great West End Street. Edgware Road, the straightest road in London, built by the Romans. Archway Road, the first bypass road built by monks. How long ago do you think? Only 500 years ago. Miles and miles of new roads have been built to cope with increasing demands, like this on Western Avenue. No sooner are they finished than they are found to be inadequate. The River Thames is a very big part of London. How to cross it easily is always a problem. There are 20 bridges over the Thames in London. Very much like these new ones at Chelsea and Chiswick. Every possible means must be used to deal with London's tremendous transport problem. This Blackwall Tunnel, built about 50 years ago under the river, is soon to be used for one-way traffic only, as soon as another tunnel can be built alongside. There has been a lot of talk about restoring the past glories of the River Thames. This river of liquid history. It is difficult to realize that river traffic existed long before roads. It is not at all impossible that the very force of progress will bring back old ideas, and that the River Thames will be the means of carrying a lot more passengers to and fro by means of electric boats, river taxis, river buses, and river trains. recreation are as necessary as work itself. They are the beginning of good health and the foundation of good citizens. So we will start from the young, on the Londoners of tomorrow. Every park has its own nanny's parade, this one at St. James's Park. Fishing with nets while they're young. That Biggin's mine, I caught him. If you can't go to the sea, London provides Lidos, like this one at Kennington Park. Paddling. The bare idea, wherever there's a little water. Boating, when they get bigger. Young Nelsons and Drakes shoot the rapids at Regent's Park, the white stone pond. Playgrounds in all the parks and recreation grounds. Cricketers must start young, and so you see the future of flannel pools in the parks. And their critics. But the big game is the great thing. What you read about in the papers and talk about all over the country. You see why the messenger boy is in such a hurry. A great social event of the season. Eton versus Harrow. Boys from these schools have done their share in building the country and the empire. We hope that the time has arrived when the good things which these schools provide will be more accessible and available to all worthy boys of the country. And tennis. Tennis everywhere. With many a rabbit shouting, "Who'll stop me from being a Fred Berry?" A large number of Londoners enjoy their houseboats and motor launches on the Thames. Serpentine in Hyde Park. And Lido's all over London, thanks to George Lansbury. Watch them rushing in all directions, especially at weekends. On bicycles made for one, on bicycles made for two, and romance on the great highway. Buses are used for outings as well as for going to work. And, of course, innumerable cars and coaches. For the less energetic, London has more parks than any place in the world. Battersea Park, place of lilies and loveliness, where lovelies hurry from their typewriters to lunch and breathe a while. Watch Mother Dab Chick giving Baby Dab Chick her lunch. Londoners do love their birds. Are they friendly? Yes. A crumb in the hand is worth two in the bag. In Hyde Park, not Londoners this time, American tourists get the habit. Swans are superior birds, like the Regent's Park we adore. Large numbers of Londoners visit them. And you won't mind seeing them on the beach at Chelsea, coming out of Father Thames for a wash and brush up. Life isn't so formal at Kennington Park, down the old Kent Road, but they enjoy themselves just the same. In Leicester Square Gardens, there's a statue of William Shakespeare, surrounded by picture theatres which are so popular that he is said to be wondering if he wouldn't have done better after all to write for the film. Even on the embankment, there are lovely gardens and farms. Who's who at the zoo? Even on the brightest day, someone has the hump there. Mr. Leo, just a lick and a promise, in honor of the ladies. Now you see where Charlie Chaplin got his walk. Pets corner. The kiddies delight. They say you are going to leave us. Believe me, you will be found wherever they put you. London's very own racetrack, Alexander Park. Ah, somebody you know. I've got an horse, I've got an horse. Prince Monolulu to you, but never his royal shyness. And no racetrack would be complete without somebody trying on the confidence trick, would it? Find the lady? Now, hard luck. Scrambling for coppers, always after the favourite one. Pennies from heaven. Let's all go to Epi Hempstead, best known of all the fairgrounds in the world. They earn their little bit of straw, don't you think? Roll up there, roll up. Ladies and gentlemen, roll up, roll up. Here we are, just gonna start again. Roll up, roll up, be in time, be in time. These people are really happy, but Londoners do take their pleasure sadly. Smile, darling, smile. Draw your string, boys. Come along, draw your string. Ring the bell every time, draw your string. Hi, mister. Give us another penny, please. We ain't giving them away, you know. Three shots a penny, every hit a coconut. In Rotten Row, there is great dignity where kings and commoners take the air. Some there are, too many according to some, or too few according to others, who like their recreation tempered with learning. They go to museums, stuck away in all sorts of nooks and corners, built before the days of town planning. Victoria and Albert Museum. The Natural History Museum in South Kensington. The Imperial War Museum. The Science Museum. The British Museum, which had more than 1.5 million visitors last year, an average of 30,000 per week. What helps to make London important and great is that all these national institutions are here. But perhaps more important than any of these is London's commercial importance. This bit of London, worth its weight in gold, you see it without traffic. You write to the Royal Exchange or the Bank of England. Bishopsgate is as old as London itself. St. Paul's in the city of London. Surprising to find how well the daily services are attended by people from the city. Now let's go over to Piccadilly. The centre will meet anyone you know, sooner or later. Usually later. 11-ish. Theatre Royal, Drury Lane. Built, rebuilt and built again. The sort of thing London does so well with its very special building. At Trafalgar Square, Nelson still holds the fort. Though it's rumoured he's complaining of the electric signs. They dazzle his one and only eye. Chelsea Hospital. Home of the boys of the old brigade. Law courts, models of justice the world over, while lawyers in the quiet chambers of the temple consider how best to leave no stone unturned in the interest of their clients. Bow Street Police Station, a nice place to keep out of. The British Medical Association, doing its part for the health of the country without ever advertising the thing. You see the stalk, you know where life begins. The Royal Institute of British Architects, using its influence to beautify the country. Listen, this is the national program. Next door is Queen's Hall, home of the promenade concerts. Never a seat vacant here. Classical music is not dead yet. Greenwich Observatory, giving the world the mean time of its life. Horse guards on parade. Whitehall. Always busy on national, empire and international problems, trying to solve everybody's crossword. Before concluding, we ought to say that we have not been trying to show you the sights of London, but real London and Londoners, just as passers-by can see it. County Hall on one side of Westminster Bridge, from which place London is governed. May we whisper it, pretty well governed too. On the other side of the same bridge, the Houses of Parliament, governing the country, to say the least of it, and in order to avoid rousing any political passion, doing their best whichever party happens to be in power. And Buckingham Palace, which governs the Empire. The royal standard flutters. Here's a health to their majesties. The King and Queen are at home.